the summer of 1994. I was 7 years old at the border. My sister and I were hiding in the back of my dad's yellow truck under two piñatas. My dad was driving, my mom sitting next to him. Brenda y Juliana, paren de hablar. Stop whispering, my mom yelled. No nos pueden descubrir. We can't get caught. We pull up to the checkpoint, and I heard a strong, loud voice. The officer asked my dad questions, then silence. Finally, the car started moving faster. The wind came through the windows. The wheels slid away from the border and into San Diego. We made it. Now my dad needed to find work. He was lucky this time and was given a permit to work in the United States legally. He also started the process to become a resident. We knew it was going to take years, but Mama didn't want to go back to Tijuana because she knew moving back could affect us in school and maybe our behavior. Within a few days, my dad found a job refinishing bathrooms and kitchens, and he was going to get paid good money. After 7 full years of working, he finally had his residency interview. When I heard the news, I started thinking about all the things we will be able to do, like visiting my grandma in Mexico. My mom looked worried because she knew more than me about this situation. Because a lot of the time, the government will not give you a resident card just because the officer woke up that morning in a bad mood, even if you have everything they asked for. Finally, the day arrived. Immigration told my dad to go to Ciudad Juarez for his interview. Vents know for the Mexican drug war and the murder of women. Even though I was scared, I felt excited because finally, everyone in my family was going to be legal. And this means no more wasting on lawyers, no more money wasting on lawyers. But the officer in Ciudad Juarez did wake up in a bad mood. I wanted this to be a pesadilla, a nightmare that I could wake up from. We moved back to Tijuana, even though I didn't want to live there, and my dream of learning English and going to college disappeared. In 2002, my family decided to come back to the United States. This time, my mom and us kids could cross legally, but my dad couldn't. After September 11, the border became really hard to cross. The laws became even stricter. My dad decided to cross by El Centro and through Tecate. My mom didn't approve, but she knew that he was going to do it no matter what she said. Crossing by the desert is really dangerous. Imagine walking in the dark around snakes and coyotes or twisting your ankle. He could have died from lack of food and water. Those three days felt like years. We didn't sleep waiting for the phone to ring. I was worried about him. Maybe the Border Patrol caught him. At 6 in the morning, the phone finally rang, and I knew it was my dad. My mom didn't even let it ring twice before she answered it. I saw my mom smile, and I cursed and started jumping from happiness. When he got home, he had bruises on his arm. His lips looked purple and all burned from the sun. But he was alive and back with us safe. After a week, I heard my mom talking to my dad about saving money to get a lawyer. My dad started working legally again for the same company, refurnishing bathrooms and kitchens. He bought a new truck, a Dodge Dakota. Every 3 months, my mom took $500 to the new lawyer. Her name was Sharon, a nice old white lady. How could I forget her name when she was getting my family savings? When we wanted something from the store, my mom would say, "No puedo. I need to pay the lawyer." I hated it. After a year, my mom finally finished paying $5,000 to Sharon. My dad received a letter for his second interview. I got excited because this time it was going to be at the Chula Vista Immigration Office. He didn't have to leave the U.S. My dad's interview was on his birthday, August 3rd. My hands started sweating. We woke up at 5 in the morning to see him las mañanitas. And then he prepared for his interview. Because my English was better, I called Sharon to let her know we were on our way. She sounded so positive and calm about this interview that I started feeling better too. The day was hot and windy. Leaves moved from one side of the street to another. As we got out of the car, I kept looking at my dad's face. He looked scared and excited. I still wonder what his real feelings were. Inside, the officer asked for identification. He had a deep voice, made me feel really very scared and intimidated. "Have a seat," he said. "You will be called in a couple minutes." The appointment was at 10. It was already 10:15. My dad had not been called. A few minutes later, an officer opened the door and asked for Alfonso Orozco Sosa, my dad. In the waiting room, I prayed. Every second felt like hours. My hands started sweating, and I could not stop my foot from bouncing. The door opened slowly, and I saw my dad's sad and angry face. He did not have to say anything. We walked outside, silent and confused. Sharon said she didn't know what happened. His paperwork was correct. My dad was really upset by this time. The reason the officer denied him his green card was because he had left the country when he went to Ciudad Juarez for his first interview. Even though they were the ones that sent him there, I felt a hole in my chest and I began to cry. "What can I do?" my dad asked Sharon. "I don't want to move back to Tijuana." She said, "Well, we can still do something about your case, but it will cost another $5,000. I still think she was crazy. There was no way we can afford another mistake like this. That was the last time we saw Sharon, the lawyer. Immigration gave my dad 30 days to get out of the U.S. We were all sad, but still had hope. Again, I heard my parents talking about getting another lawyer, one that would cost them less money. The one they found only charges $2,500. His face was plastered across huge billboards besides the freeways and occurs at the border. Maybe you have heard of him or see his advertisements. Let's call him the asshole. My parents' savings were going to disappear again. I am the oldest child in my family, and I'm nosy too. But now, I wanted to know everything about my dad's case. I hide behind doors so I can listen to my parents' conversation. One day, I heard them say that this was going to be the last time they spend money on this case. They fully trusted the asshole. I was not sure why, but I think maybe it was because he's on TV. Sometimes people are ignorant. We believe that famous people won't lie, that they would do the correct thing. 2 months later, the asshole called. My dad had a court date in just 4 days. Worry ran through my family like wind. The next morning, looking at my dad, eyes were puffy. He had not slept in days. We all got in the car again, headed to the court hearing again. Inside the courthouse, we waited for my dad's name to be called again. But where was the asshole? Where was a famous attorney? And guess what? He never showed up. He sent one of his assistants, and we quickly realized he knew nothing about our case. He was going to win it. At this point, we panicked. It was too late to make changes, too late to do anything about it. Before we knew it, my dad's name was called. All we could do was hope for the best. My father and the assistant made their way to the front of the courtroom. The judge asked, "What is the reason for this hearing?" And then the asshole assistant said, "We are here to ask for voluntary deportation." In less than a second, the judge stamped the paper and gave my my father 20 days to leave the U.S. We were all shocked about what just happened. That is not what we wanted. My dad could not speak. My mom asked the assistant why he said that. She tried to tell him that we wanted to fight this case. The assistant could only reply that this is what the asshole had told him to do. By this time, my father was so pissed that we walked straight to the car and took off in a flash to the asshole office. I could hear the wheels of the car screeching as we took every turn. My mom and I were scared. We had never seen my father that mad. We were not sure what was going to happen once we got to the office. At the front desk, we were told that the case was closed and our lawyer was gone for the day. We could not do anything about it. I knew the asshole was there because I saw his car in the parking lot. My father decided he was not going to follow the judge's decision. He was not sure what to do, but he knew he did not want to go back to Mexico. A few weeks passed, and one night, we were watching the news and saw the Border Patrol raiding a house. We all got scared, and for a good reason. Less than a week later, we had the same thing happen to us. At 4:30 in the morning, we had a knock on the door. Border Patrol's agent surrounded the house. They were everywhere. He had no place to go. I still remember the sound of their boots running up the stairs and the sound of them clearing the rooms. They came in high power guns and treated him like he was a terrorist. They did not even give him a chance to change out of his pajamas and into his regular clothes. I watched my mom cry, and I did everything I could to hold back, but it got to the best of me too. My mom, sister, and brother moved back to Mexico to be with him. I stayed in the United States alone, hoping that things would change. They did not. For 1 year after they left, every time I talked to my mom, she would ask me to move to Tijuana, but I couldn't. My life was here in San Diego. She worried about me being alone, but I knew I could not just leave. I need to work. I needed to work and help them with money. My father got a job in Mexico. He sells appliances, but it only goes so far. This past summer, I became a U.S. citizen. I pay off my dad's truck. I'm learning how to be alone, independent, and strong. I enrolled in college so I can get a better job and help out my family more. I talk to my family almost every day, but food never tastes the same once I started eating alone. I want my family back.